welcome to another episode of Family Matters. I'm Chloe Learey, the executive director of the Winston Prouty Center. And Family Matters is a talk show where we talk about issues of interest to families with young children. So we are here today with a special guest, Nancy McMahon. And Nancy is the infant teacher at the Winston Prouty Center. We just added infant care. We added it when we moved to our new home mm-hmm. on the campus. We added an infant room, and Nancy helped bring it to life. Mm-hmm. And it's very lively. It's very full of lively infants. We were really excited to have somebody with your experience come help us develop the program and to offer this in the community, because it's really a need mm-hmm. to find high-quality infant care. So it's going great, I mm-hmm. think. Tell us a little bit about yourself and just what you've done, your experience, and then we'll launch into our topic.
Okay. I've been in early ed and special ed for about 30 years. I actually, early in my career, started out here in Vermont and taught in an infant program, and then director preschool program, and then I went across the river to New Hampshire, and I was a teaching director there for 10 years, and then switched hats and went into special ed, and did that for 10 years, and now I feel like I'm full circle.
Yay.
Now I feel like I'm doing both, that's why I came to Winston Prouty. Mm-hmm. I wasn't even really looking, and then I saw this opportunity and uh-huh. thought that I really wanted to do this because I really believe in the Rye philosophy, and I wanted to bring it mm-hmm. to you all at Winston.
That's so great. So that's why we're here. We're going to talk about what you brought with the Rye philosophy of working with infants. Mm-hmm. So what does RISE stand for?
RISE stands for Resources for Infant Educators, and it was created by a woman called Magda Gerber, and she brought it over from Budapest, Hungary, and settled in LA and began the program there on teaching parents and caregivers mm-hmm. how to care for children according to her philosophy that she created with Dr. Emmy Pickler in Budapest, Hungary.
Mm-hmm. And what... what was her, she's not a pediatrician.
She is not a pediatrician. She was a mother. And she had a sick daughter.
Okay.
And she took her sick daughter. This was at the end of World War II mm-hmm. In Hungary. And she took her daughter to the doctor, or the doctor back then came to the home. Uh-huh. And the doctor asked what was wrong. And Magda went to go answer for her daughter. And Dr. Pickler stopped her. And mm-hmm. she addressed the conversation to the daughter, where the daughter was able to explain in detail what was wrong, how it hurt, what it felt like, and Dr. Pickler was able to get a lot more information from the daughter mm-hmm. than she would have from the mother. So for Magda Gerber, this was kind of an aha moment, mm-hmm. and that began her work with Dr. Pickler. So they ended up doing a study in, they found an orphanage, and they created this philosophy and went into this orphanage where children were not thriving. They were not doing well, mm-hmm. as you can imagine, what the climate might have been like in Budapest, Hungary mm-hmm. at the end of World War II. And they were able to go in and prove that by treating each infant authentically mm-hmm. And working on a caring and nurturing relationship and allowing that child to be an active participant, these infants were able to thrive. They were able to go out in society and be productive. They were able to create bonds. Mm-hmm. And
nice.
Yeah.
So, then, so let's, you started to go through the philosophy a little bit. So let's, let's do that. Let's visit. What are the, you know, sort of tenets of this approach to working with
infants, but
it sounds to me like really you could apply this to sort of relationships or working with kids and people.
I mean, I took a workshop 15 years ago, and I feel like it was so life-changing for me that I think I've carried it over into everything mm-hmm. that I've done mm-hmm. since then. So I had left early ed and went into special ed, and I thought that this Rye philosophy was perfect for working with special ed population mm-hmm. because what you want to do is slow down to their pace, mm-hmm. Let them initiate. I mean, things that we'll go through this,
okay.
And then
sounds good.
We'll break it down. But I felt like working with the special ed population, this was mm-hmm. just as effective.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Good. So where do we start? What do you think are the most?
Yeah, well, we communicate
wherever.
Authentically. So we, you know, most, when we see babies, what do? We go into this hi voice.
You're so cute.
And what do babies do? How do they respond to it? You know, what we want to do is treat them like people, mm-hmm. and create a bond and a relationship. And so when parents come in the morning with their children, I say hello to them, and then I say hello to the babies. Mm-hmm. And I get down, and I make that eye contact, mm-hmm. and I talk to them, and I say, how are you doing today? Are you ready for, you know, so I have a conversation. Mm-hmm. I don't talk. I try not to talk, baby talk, mm-hmm. to them, but to invite them into the conversation that I'm having with the parent and mm-hmm. make it about them. Mm-hmm. So communicating authentically. And then we invite babies to actively participate in the caregiving activities. And this has been really important. So the caregiving activities that we have during our day is changing, mm-hmm. feeding, mm-hmm. napping, getting dressed to go outside, or just getting dressed. Mm-hmm. And so those are your teachable moments. Those are the times that you're really going to spend working with the child and inviting them to initiate in the activity, mm-hmm. with you, because eventually you're going to want them to do these independently. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about 4 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, 10 months, 12 right. months. So when you do these activities, you explain what you're going to do. Mm-hmm. You never just pick up a baby. You never just change them and have a conversation, mm-hmm. which is very hard to stay focused. Mm-hmm. And you explain what you're going to do and wait for them to initiate some kind of a response. Hmm. So I'll say, I'm going to change you now. And I wait for them to respond in some way. So I'm beginning that conversation, mm-hmm. that give and take conversation, mm-hmm. with them. Mm-hmm.
Which is one of those skills, that like give and take and exchange. So I think some people would think, a 2-month-old, are you kidding? But so tell me, like, of a little baby, what's the kind of response you might look for that's that exchange? Because they're clearly, okay. gonna say, sure, Nancy, that sounds great, you know.
So if I have a child, first I'll invite them. I'm going to pick you up now. It's time to change your diaper. Mm-hmm. And I'll put out my hands. So for some babies, if they're able to, they'll put their hands out. Mm-hmm. And that's saying, yes, okay, you can pick me up. Some babies will make some kind of emotion or move or make that eye contact and smile, mm-hmm. depending on how, you know, where they, mm-hmm. are at their development, mm-hmm. and how young, mm-hmm. they are. So
what if they don't want to?
Then you talk to them about it, mm. just like I would talk to you about, mm-hmm. it if you and I had, mm-hmm. a difference. Sometimes when you're going to do an activity, there might be some trauma around it, mm-hmm. you know, so, mm-hmm. you really, mm-hmm. have to talk and you have to wait. So I will have babies that don't like to be changed. Wow, that seems to make you really sad. So I'll kind of step it back a little, mm-hmm. and then we'll talk about it. And then I'll try again, mm-hmm. you know, are you ready to try, you know, mm-hmm. and then we'll try it again.
I'm curious about the talking again, like people don't think of little babies as talking or communicating, but so sort of you using verbal words and talking, I'm guess you have used your body too, I guess, as communication.
Yep.
So I'm hearing and seeing talking as sort of this whole communication package.
Right. There's like a lot of language
that it's you know, sort of invitation, mm-hmm. And narrating and, mm-hmm. sort of several pieces to the communication.
Yeah, yeah. It's what your face is doing.
Right.
You know, they're sponges. They're taking in everything.
Right.
They understand more than we do because, mm-hmm. we've over the years kind of have built up these filters. They
right.
don't have those.
Right.
So they're very receptive. And it's cool when you first start doing it and you see the reactions, mm-hmm. that they're giving you, and it, you know, mm-hmm. it's pretty, mm-hmm. Awakening, I guess. Is
about how aware they really are.
About how aware and right. how they are born with these innate gifts and, mm-hmm. talents, and they know how to communicate. Mm-hmm. They are born knowing how to communicate. Mm-hmm. We just don't always see it.
Mm-hmm. Great, good. So communication.
Yep. Okay.
Invitation, looking for responses.
We encourage uninterrupted self-directed play. So the theory behind that is we become passive, so they become active. Mm-hmm. So what we do with babies a lot is we tend to try and pacify them all the time, but that limits them. So we pick these times during the day where we kind of sit back. I have the environment set up to kind of invite them into different corners of the room, and I have different things in baskets and hidden in different places, and I let them explore. Mm-hmm. And hopefully I have the room, you know, set up safe enough and secure enough for them to actively explore the room without any intervention from me. And then I can sit back and observe. This is my observing time. So I can really watch what they're doing developmentally. I'm taking notes of what they did last week and what they did this week. I'm seeing things happen for the first time, which is really, really exciting. And then I might do a narration, or they call it sports casting. So I might sit back and just be very objective about what they're doing. You know, Janie, I'm noticing that, you know, you pulled out the blue ball, you know, things like that.
That narration then helps them make connections too. Again, taking advantage of this really receptive time that they, you know, you don't have to show them a flashcard of blue over and over and say blue, blue, blue. It's like, oh, the blue ball. Oh, or, you know, that
and
narration.
And this sounds like it's really easy to sit back and be passive. It's not.
No.
Because you have to trust the baby's innate abilities. And sometimes you'll see these baby doing things or crawling all over each other, or and you have to really sit on your hands and trust their ability that they know what they're doing.
They're going to figure something out.
And that
out.
It's purposeful. Yeah. And that, right. And then you're allowing them to have that, those aha moments. You're allowing them to be the inventors. We're not inventing it for them. They're inventing it for themselves. It's exciting.
But I did hear you talk about sort of creating the environment and the opportunity. So, because I think some people, you know, think about, well, what's my responsibility as an adult or a teacher, or I have to, you know, I'm supposed to impart knowledge or supposed to do these things or make sure they, that even if it's passive, that sort of implies that you haven't done anything. In fact, you've done so much work to create a place that this can happen safely.
Exactly.
And then observing it is sort of your, I guess I'm thinking you are engaged because you're observing.
Yeah.
And that will then change how you might change the room, you might respond.
Right, right, because I'm using my environment as a teacher. If I've set up my environment well, then I will have to do less intervention. The environment will do it for me.
Which is like a famous phrase, I think, right? The environment is the third teacher, or, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Right. Great, good.
Should we roll on to the next one?
Yeah, let's do it.
We allow children to develop motor and cognitive skills naturally. So in doing this with infants, we do not put them in any positions that they can't put themselves in. So with a newborn or a three, we get them at 6 weeks, you know, we start on our backs. So I wouldn't prop a baby up. We don't have any exercise tossers in our room. We don't have any jumpers in our room. We do have like pillows and boppies to help buffer them, but we don't put them in positions. We allow them to find those positions.
Are there times when, I'm just thinking of like some kids, it's good for them to practice tummy time, or you know, there are sort of physical things we want to help them learn. So are there times when we you either encourage them to do more of something? How, what is that, what might that look like, I guess?
Yeah, well, there's a couple of things that go on in our room. We have intervention that comes in. So they will purposely put children, because they're working on certain goals and doing certain things with them. So of course we support that. And then, you know, there's the whole movement about babies being on their backs. And what's starting to happen to these babies is they're getting flat heads. So we do encourage tummy time and putting them in different positions. We might prop them on their sides just because of the flat head. Concerns.
Yeah. What about, you said no extra saucers or jumpy things. Mm-hmm. Is that always, like, you would never have that in your room? Like, they're so prevalent, I guess, is what I'm thinking. Like, wow, everybody has that. Why?
Yeah, they are so prevalent. And, I mean, a lot of this, it's not rocket science, but it's a different, it's like flipping the switch, mm-hmm. really. I mean, it's a different perspective. I mean, the reason why, what happens in an exosaucer? What happens when you put a child in an exosaucer? You're restraining them.
Right, it's
You're
convenient.
Making them passive.
Yeah,
they
okay.
can't move. And that's not what we want. We want these children to be competent and confident and mm-hmm. exploring mm-hmm. and initiating. Mm-hmm. They can't do that in mm-hmm. an exosaucer. Mm-hmm. They can't do that in a restrained mm-hmm. environment. And of course, I mean, we do have eating times. They are in little chairs. I mean, you've seen our chairs.
Right.
The whole room is scaled down mm-hmm. for an infant. Mm-hmm. So the chairs are very low to the ground, but they do sit in mm-hmm. them, and they do have mm-hmm. A restraint on them so mm-hmm. they don't fall out.
Yeah, it's not total free range.
No.
I can go in the corner.
This is really an experiment. In Winston Prouty, we've never had an infant program there. And, you know, it's the first time that I've been able to bring it into an infant room, so I'm still learning. Mm. I'm still learning to retrain my brain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely.
We are going to take a short break and hear a message from Let's Grow Kids, and then we will come back and talk some more about this.
Great.
For the youngest among us, playtime is more than just fun. It's learning and development. When we stimulate a child's curiosity and natural desire to connect with others, we help them develop the important skills needed for school, relationships, and life. Join Let's Grow Kids to help all of our children reach their full potential. Learning starts day one.
And we're back. We're talking about working with infants, an approach developed by Magda Gerber mm-hmm. called Response.
Resources for infant educators.
I think I keep thinking it must be like, let's be responsive to infants education
yeah.
or something. So, so it's an approach of working with infants that we are using in our new infant room at Prouty. We mm-hmm. were just talking about letting sort of kids naturally be part of their environment and explore and helping them be competent and confident, and how that's kind of a switch in our brains for, you know, we are used to protecting kids or putting them in, you know, bouncy chairs or stuff that's convenient for adults sometimes because I got to do the dishes. I can't have any room around the floor, but which is, you know, I think a reality. But what is hard about that switch? You know, you're saying, like, as we keep learning, what do you think are some of the biggest barriers for us being able to interact with infants this way?
Well, our culture. I mean, culturally, you know, it's been embedded on how we treat children. And so I think this approach is a little different from what we're used to practicing.
Mm-hmm.
And what was your question again?
What's challenging about this different approach?
It is challenging. Mm-hmm. I think because it's so embedded and we're so used to taking care of them and doing things for them. Mm-hmm. And this approach is doing things with them mm-hmm. and inviting them into the process of mm-hmm. doing it with you. Mm-hmm. You're not doing it to mm-hmm. them. And when I say doing it, I'm talking about caring for them, changing them, feeding them. It's something we talk about before we start the process of feeding or changing or mm-hmm. And then wait for them to initiate that they're ready and, mm-hmm. and to be part of that mm-hmm. process.
Mm-hmm. And what I like about that is that sort of, again, that invitation and joining mm-hmm. versus doing things too, which I think philosophically matches across all our work at the Prouty Center in terms of we join families if we're working with families or kids, or that we're not doing things to people. We're
right.
partners in whatever way we can to
right.
and with each other's colleagues, frankly.
Because
even.
Think of it from an adult point of view. If somebody were to come and just pick you up
right.
or move you
right.
without talking to you or just stick food in your mouth
right.
without
right.
presenting it to you first mm-hmm. and how that mm-hmm. feels. And so that's something that I try to kind of, you know, how would this feel for me
mm-hmm.
and how does it feel
mm-hmm.
for this child?
And it's about respect, it seems to me. Like, just respecting you are a person on this planet, too, and just because you're little and I can pick you up and move you around doesn't mean I should.
Right. because you are authentic and you have your own innate gifts, and I'm going to respect and trust them.
Mm-hmm. And I think it helps with that, you know, if you think about what are we doing in early education? Mm-hmm. We're doing exactly helping them grow into people who can participate fully in the world to the best of their ability. Correct. If we do things to kids, right, they're not learning how right to do those
right
next things.
And what's so beautiful about this, I mean, when you look at the different models of early ed that we have, there aren't any found philosophies for infants.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it usually starts at preschool is where we start to see those, mm-hmm, that structure, mm-hmm, of how should we raise our children, how should we raise, mm-hmm, them in the classroom. And this is specific for infants and toddlers. Mm-hmm. So infants, mm-hmm, 1 year, 2 year.
Which is, you know, I think so interesting given what we know about brain science now, that if 80% of the brain is developed by age three, then we've missed this whole time.
I know.
Like, it's so important.
It's so incredible because the brain is still regenerating. And that, like, is the most exciting part about this work for me, mm-hmm, is, like, so much is going on, mm-hmm, and so quickly, mm-hmm, even in the last 2 months, mm-hmm, since we've started this, to see how they've progressed in 2 months, mm-hmm, is incredible. I think what they do in the first few years is more than they'll develop in their college career, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, it's just, it's huge.
Yeah, in terms of brain development and synapses, it's way more.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean that you're sort of stuck in time. I think, you know, I'd be worried, it's like, oh, there are three, we're done with them. That, you know, it's like, there are developmental points, for sure. I've had that exchange with some people. It's like, well, it's not just the early years. I'm like,
the early years are
So critical, and that's why it is so important that we have quality environments for little people to be in. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think, you know, depending on what people think about putting your kids in early care and education versus staying at home, like, the reality of our culture is we do have early care and education settings because that's how it works. So let's make them the best we can and understand why it's so important to do it right.
Right.
Or well. There's, you know, it's like, we can't be perfect, but this, it seems to me that what I like about this approach is, it's not rigid. It doesn't strike me as you do things this way. It's an approach.
It is an approach.
So how is it going to work in this moment?
And then, you know, we're Rye-inspired. So, you know, there's other things that I'm bringing into the classroom, mm-hmm, too, but I'm definitely trying this on and bringing it with me, and every day I'm learning more of how to use it, mm-hmm, and use it well. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, I'm learning. It's only been 2 months, so I'm giving myself the year to really embrace, mm-hmm, the Rye into my room. Mm-hmm. And
are there some things we haven't talked about yet in terms of things people might want to know about the approach that we haven't touched on?
Well, we value intrinsic motivation and inner directedness. Mm-hmm. So we try not to overpraise. So a lot of my comments will be like observations. And like I said, I try to stay objective. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's really important. Encouraging a child to express their emotions. And so when children cry, I won't necessarily go up and pick them up and try to pacify them. Mm-hmm. I'll go and talk to them. Wow, you sound really, mm-hmm, sad. What's making you sad? You know, it's an open conversation. I'm going to comfort them and nurture them, but I'm inviting them into that process so that they can kind of try to figure out what's going on too. These kids are receptive. They understand what you're saying, mm-hmm, to them. Mm-hmm. We allow children to problem solve and experience and learn from age-appropriate conflicts. And so I will let the babies take toys from each other. I will let them figure it out. When they first came into the room, they had like this baby salute. They would like crawl up to each other and it would just be like, eh. And it's changed and evolved. But when it first started happening, I was like, oh no.
Oh dear. No, we can't have this.
But it's changed and they're all really starting to have these beautiful relationships, and they're becoming, mm-hmm, friends, and they're starting to respond to each other, and they're not doing this anymore.
They're not pushing each other away. That's
but they
great.
Do pats, yeah. And you know, they'll do these. First, they were just taking toys, and now they're playing these give and take games. So, I mean, they're learning how to share, and they're doing it. And I'm not having to be there to say, oh, Johnny, you need to share that story.
Which is, you know, it's so, actually in our last episode, I was talking with Billy Slade about play-based learning and how much learning is happening in those moments. And what's resonating right now for me is, one, thinking about the authenticity piece of this and how you can't make people share and you can't make people say, I'm sorry. I mean, you can, but
no,
people, they will know that it's not authentic. And so in that, you know, taking things and then learning to give back and forth and you narrating and observing,
right,
not telling them.
And they're doing it naturally.
And they're doing it naturally.
As their relationships are evolving.
So can you imagine if, you know, imagine the preschool classroom that is full of the kids from this infant classroom, right? Like that is really exciting. I think we'll get to see that. I hope that you know, and it's certainly one of the topics that comes up so much is how behaviors are exploding. Kids are getting kicked out of preschool. You know, they might talk about school readiness and knowing, well, they better know their letters and numbers. Like, no, they better know how to be with people and each other.
Right.
So that's what I'm just sort of thinking about, how that this can really sort of support that.
This is the beginning of socialization.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And it's group care. I mean, we are doing group care here. So they are learning how to be part of something bigger than themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which I think has to be part of what we're doing, you know, and if I think of with peers even, you know, so part of, you know, one of the foundational things about Winston Prouty is this idea of an inclusive environment, which doesn't just mean we have, you know, kids with special needs in our program. It means that we all belong here somehow. Mm-hmm. And so that's, you know, I think a human tendency. And so there's a nice alignment there, I think, with how are we all going to be included here?
Right. So. And that's what I love about Prouty, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good. I know it's hard to believe we're running out of time. Is there one, something we haven't gotten to about this topic that you feel like you want to make sure people know before we sign off?
No, I mean, I think, you know, to put it in a nutshell, you know, treat every person that you come in contact with authentically, respectfully, and in a caring nature, and that's, you know, for everyone I work with, and for the children that come in my room, and the parents.
And right, again, it seems to me like this approach can apply to all of those relationships.
Absolutely.
That it doesn't have to be like, oh, I'm going to be this way with the babies.
Right.
But I'm going to be this way in the world and hope that I can share that with other people. I think that is a wonderful match for us, and I am so glad you have brought this to Prouty, and I'm excited to see how it develops and how those infants grow up into the lovely citizens we want them to be.
Great. Me too.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.